Good morning. Indeed, no other name has power to save but Jesus Christ. Last night I met somebody who wished me all the best for my preaching, and I was surprised. How do you know I'm preaching tomorrow? So I just learned that now there's e-bulletin, and so some people had received the bulletin earlier in the week. And so you might have seen that the scripture text is Acts 25 and 26, but the sermon title is By All Means Save Some. And you may be wondering, what is Richard up to? How does he get that title out of this scripture text? Well, I'll show you later on. Let's go to God in prayer first. Lord Jesus, we thank you that it is by your name that we are saved. And Lord, this morning as we look at the word of God, and as we ponder what it has to say to us, Lord, we ask that you will speak to each one of us according to our personal needs in a very individual way, so that we will each hear your word according to what we most need. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we are on this sermon series through Acts. And I was given Acts chapter 25 and chapter 26, and I read it many, many times. I didn't just read it in different versions. I also listened to it on audio Bible, and I was thinking, how am I going to get a sermon out of this long text, you know? And so I read it many, many times, and in the end, I found inspiration in one of the verses. We will see how it goes. So the background text begins with Acts chapter 25, the first segment, verse 1 to verse 5. This is where Festus is said to have rejected the Jewish authorities' request to bring Paul from Caesarea to Jerusalem. And probably Festus could see through that plot, because the Jewish people were plotting, right, that if Festus would allow Paul to be brought from Jerusalem to Caesarea, along the way they would have him killed. They were plotting to assassinate him en route. And Festus would not give in to that, right? And why, we're not very sure, but according to the Jewish historian Josephus, Festus is a more upright governor than his predecessor, Felix. The next segment, from verse 6 to verse 13, Paul is brought before Festus, and the hearing ends with that famous declaration by Paul, when he said, I appeal to Caesar, right? And because Paul says, I appeal to Caesar, he cannot be summarily judged and executed or whatever. He has to be sent to Rome to be given a fair trial that all Roman citizens were entitled to. And then from verse 14 to 21, Festus introduces Paul's case to King Agrippa. And King Agrippa is the eighth and the last of the Herodian dynasty. Why did Festus introduce Paul's case to Agrippa? We think that probably because Festus didn't know how to present Paul's case in Rome, and he was hoping that Agrippa would give him some insight. The text then continues with chapter 26, and in the first segment from verse 2 to verse 11, Paul is presented before Festus and Agrippa, and he recounts his pre-conversion life, how he was scrupulously observing the Jewish way of life, and how he was religiously very zealous in following the law, including his fervor in persecuting Christians. From verse 12 to verse 18, Paul describes his encounter with Christ and his commissioning to be a witness for Christ in that very famous, very well-known story, right? The road to Damascus, where Christ appeared to him. Following that, from verse 19 to verse 23, Paul describes his post-conversion life, in particular his missionary endeavors and how the Jews plotted to kill him. And then he ends with this brief declaration of the gospel, that Christ has suffered and died and risen from the dead. And also he mentions again his commitment to proclaim the message to both Jews and Gentiles. At this point, Festus concludes that Paul is out of his mind, that too much learning has driven him insane. And to that, Paul argues that all he has said is in fact very reasonable. And he turns to Agrippa, who is familiar with the Jewish religion, to confirm what he has said. Paul kind of puts Agrippa in a corner, saying to him, "Do you believe the prophets? I know you do." And at this point, Agrippa answers Paul, "Do you think that in such a short time you can persuade me to be a Christian?" And then Paul gives his reply. "Short time or long, I pray to God that not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am, except for these chains." So here we see Paul affirming his intense desire, right, that everyone who heard the gospel of message, the gospel of Christ, everyone who heard his message might become like him, a Christian. The procurator, the king, the queen, the military commanders, the civic leaders, anyone at that point listening to him. Paul desired that they may all become Christians. And that is where I make my quantum leap to my sermon title, "By All Means, Save Some." By all means, save some. Where does that come from? That comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 22, the second half of it, where Paul says, I have become all things to all men, that by all means I might save some. So let us look at this verse in the context in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 19 to 23. Paul says, "For though I am free from all men, I have made myself a servant of all, that I might win the more. And to the Jews I have become a Jew, that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, not being without law toward God, but under the law toward Christ, that I might win those who are without law. To the weak I have become as weak, that I might win the weak. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. Now this I do for the gospel's sake, that I may be partaker of it with you." So let me highlight this verse. I have become all things to all men, that I might by all means save some. What can we learn from Paul's attitude, Paul's desire in evangelism? I'd like to draw three lessons. Firstly, when Paul says that I might by all means save some, Paul is affirming the fact that God has chosen to use the instrumentality of human agents. Right? It is in God's divine purpose, in his wisdom, that Christians should be his instruments to bring others to him. Now surely if God had wanted to, God could have spoken by his own voice to the entire human race, right? God could have called out with his own voice to everyone, just like he did to Paul in that encounter on the road to Damascus. But the fact remains that few are saved like Paul by a direct encounter with Christ. The majority of us came to know about Christ through a human agent. Probably all of us here, I suspect, right? Some person had done something that impressed upon us, impressed upon our hearts, something about God, right? And somebody had shared the message of Christ with us. Maybe for some of us, people had shared the message of Christ to us many, many times, right? And then finally returned to God. In any case, God has chosen in his divine purpose the instrumentality of human agents to use humans to save others. Of course, if God wanted to, he could also have sent angels to fly the length and breadth of the earth, right, and proclaim the message, but that is not his purpose. So Paul also tells us in Romans chapter 10, verse 14, he says, "How can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without someone preaching to them?" So God has purpose for us to preach to others that they may hear the message of God, the message of the gospel. And indeed, God has placed in our hearts that intense desire, that passion for the salvation of others, just as he did in the life of Paul. And that should be the distinctive feature of the Christian character. Secondly, Paul says, "I have become all things to all men." And here we see the principle of adaptability, that while the basic truth of the gospel has to remain constant, it cannot be compromised, right? The presentation of that truth can be differently packaged in different situations. Right? You do not preach to an illiterate person in the same way as you might preach to an intellectual. Right? You do not preach to somebody who doesn't speak English, right? In the same way you would preach to somebody who speaks English. And sometimes I'm very sad when I hear of situations where people are taught to read the Bible in English so that they can learn about the gospel in English. Why should a Chinese-speaking person have to read the Bible, learn to read the Bible in English to hear the gospel in English? The Chinese-speaking person should hear the gospel in Chinese. The Hindi-speaking person should hear the gospel in Hindi. The Thai-speaking person should hear the gospel in Thai. Why do we expect them to learn English to hear the gospel in English? So one of the things about adaptability is to reach out to people in the context that they are in. Of course, this shouldn't be taken out of context in isolation and stretched to the extreme, right? Otherwise, one might say, you have to be a drug abuser to reach a drug addict. You have to be a wine bibber to reach a drunkard, right? That is not what Paul means. Rather, what Paul is saying is that he would live his life in conformity to other people's lifestyle as far as it doesn't conflict with the gospel of Christ, in order that he might be identified with them and reach out to them. So to the Jews, although Paul was a born-again believer in Christ and was no longer under bondage to the Jewish law, Paul was willing, in certain circumstances, to live in conformity with Jewish customs and their way of life, in order that he might be identified with them and reach out to them. And there is much evidence of this in Scripture, because in Acts chapter 16, verse 3, we see that Paul had Timothy circumcised. Now, Paul was dead against the Judaizers who say that the Gentile believers must be circumcised and become Jew before they can become Christian, right? And so in the case of Titus, Paul refused to give in to pressure to have Titus circumcised. Titus was a Gentile. And the Gentile can be a Christian in his own right. He doesn't have to become Jew first. But Timothy was born of mixed parentage. His father was a non-Jew. His mother was a Jew. And so his Jewishness was kind of questionable, right? And Paul was bringing Timothy along with him to minister to Jews. And because of that, Paul had Timothy circumcised so that Timothy could be a full-fledged Jew and go with him into the Jewish community to minister to them. That was the extent to which Paul was willing to adapt. And in Acts chapter 18, verse 18, we also see that Paul was going through, Paul was completing a Nazarite vow, right? Now, Paul was now a born-again Christian. He had no obligation to observe Nazarite vows, but he was willing to do that as part of his identification with the Jews. And again, in chapter 20 of Acts, verse 20 to 26, we see Paul observing purification rites. Again, because the people were cautioning him, right, and asked him to do this so that the Jews would accept him, would see him as still a Jew, although he was a born-again Christian. So to the Jews, Paul was willing to be like a Jew. To those under the law, referring to those who were proselytes, non-Jews who became Jews by conversion, Paul was willing to live like them. And to those without law, referring to Gentiles, right, Paul exercises Christian freedom to live without the Jewish law. But Paul was very quick to qualify here, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ, right? Because some people were taking this Christian liberty to the extreme and saying that because we are no longer under the law of the Old Testament, under the Jewish law, we can do whatever we want and live in Christian liberty. And they took that as an excuse for their personal indulgences. So Paul quickly qualifies here, not being without law toward God, but under law toward Christ. Because there is a different motivation under the law of Christ for godly living, right? Under the Jewish law, the motivation for righteous living was fear. Fear of judgment, fear of punishment. Under the law of Christ, or the law of grace, the motivation is the love of Christ. The love for Christ drives us in our desire for holy living. And even with the weak, Paul says, the weak here referring to those of weak conscience, right? Paul says he was willing to be as the weak, to live under certain constraints, even though he knew very well he had the liberty, right, to eat meat offered to idols or whatever. But because of those of weak conscience, Paul was willing to be like the weak in order that he might preach the gospel to all and by all means save some. Thirdly, we see Paul saying, by all means save some. When Paul says, by all means save some, there is a kind of acknowledgement that not all will be saved. Right? Not all will be saved. Paul knew very well that some would respond favorably to the gospel message and some would not. So we reject the concept of universalism, that in the end, because God has love, all will be saved anyhow. You know? Don't worry, all will be saved anyway in the end, because God is a God of love. There's no way you can justify that with Scripture, right? Because Scripture makes it very clear, believe in the Lord Jesus, you will be saved. Right? So Paul would preach to anyone, anywhere, right, under any circumstances, with the hope that somehow by God's divine work, some of those who heard him would be saved. He preached in public squares, he preached in individuals' homes, he preached in a prison, he preached in before the governor, before the king, anywhere where he had the chance, he would preach the gospel. But we know not everyone responded favorably. Felix, for example, in Acts chapter 24, right, the previous segment, Felix put Paul away for a more convenient time to hear him. So procrastinating, right? Wait. Another time I'll hear him. Agrippa was nearly persuaded by Paul, and yet because of his image, because of the reputation, because he was there in front of the governor and other civic leaders, Agrippa would not embrace the message of the gospel. There are those who heard Paul and saw what he did, and they plotted to kill him. And yet, many others embraced the message of the gospel when Paul presented it. We are also familiar with John 3:16, right? A very fundamental Bible verse of the gospel message, and many of us learned to memorize it very early in our Christian life. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Now, when the Bible says, whoever believes in him shall not perish, it is also saying there are some who will not believe, right? And indeed, if you read the rest of chapter 3 of John's gospel, it tells us clearly, those who believe have been delivered, those who do not believe have been judged. So how then do we respond to Paul's example in evangelism? Paul says, I have become all things to all men, that by all means I might save some. I think, first of all, we can ask God to give us that same evangelistic fervor that Paul had. Paul said in Acts chapter 26, verse 29, when he was speaking to Agrippa, that I pray to God that not only you, but all who are listening to me today may become what I am. So we see here Paul's desire, right, that he wants everyone to believe. He knows that not everyone will believe, but that is his desire, just as God desires for all to believe. Right? But yet God cannot decree that all will believe, because God has made us with a choice, with a free will, and we have to make that choice to believe. In another verse, in Romans chapter 9, verse 3, we see Paul saying, I could wish that I myself were accursed from Christ for my brethren, for my countrymen according to the flesh. Paul wished, if it were possible, that he could die in the place of his countrymen, that they might be saved. And that reminds us of Moses. Do you remember in the story in Exodus? After the golden calf incident, God said, I will blot out the nation of Israel. Right? And of you, Moses, I will make a greater nation than Israel. What did Moses say? Thank God, Moses was not so happy. Wow, I will become greater than Israel. No. Moses said, God, if you will not forgive Israel, blot my name out of the book of life. Moses put himself between God's wrath and the nation of Israel. And he said, if you cannot forgive them, then take me along. I would rather die than to become a greater nation than they. That was the kind of love, the kind of passion, the kind of concern for others. And here Paul says, I would rather be accursed from Christ. This word accursed from Christ in Greek is anathema, which means designated for destruction, condemned for eternity. You know, it's very interesting that in Romans chapter 8, Paul is talking about who can separate us from the love of God, right? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. In Romans 8, he said that. And in Romans 9, he said, I would rather I be separated from the love of God if that could bring about the salvation of my countrymen. You know, it's like a parent pleading with a judge that they might die for their child who is convicted of a capital crime. That is the intense passion that Paul had for the salvation of others. Have you ever felt that way for someone or some people? Have you ever felt, I wish I could die for that person? But of course, we know none of us can die for another person because you and I are all sinners, equally deserving of judgment and damnation. Right? Only Christ, the sinless Lamb of God, can die on behalf of all. But when Paul says that, it shows how intense his desire was for the salvation of others. We pray God will give us that same intense passion for the salvation of others. The next thing is that we can ask God to help us in all situations, in all circumstances, to present the gospel in a way that will be most accessible to the persons God leads us to. We can learn from Paul to be adaptable, right? To be all things to all men, right? So when we are with people who are different from us, can we learn to appreciate them as they are? Or do we expect them to become like us, to become Christian? Can we learn to appreciate them as they are? Can we learn to value what they are and their way of life? Can we learn to reach out to them in their circumstances and not expect them to come to our side to hear the gospel? Now, of course, Paul is also not talking about populist preaching, yeah? In fact, in 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 3, he warns about this populist preaching, right? That in the last days, there'll be many people who will not listen to sound doctrine, but they want to hear what tickles their ear, you know, what pleases them. And they will flock to preachers who will preach what they like to hear. Paul is not talking about that. The truth of the gospel cannot be compromised. But the packaging, the presentation, the way we try to bring it across to other people, and the way we live a life in order to be a witness to Christ, all those things can be adapted. The third thing is we can ask God to help us to live in such a way that we are always doing good to others, always sharing the gospel of the message of the gospel whenever there's a chance, right? Because only God knows what the outcome will be, right? Paul says, by all means, I might save some, because Paul doesn't know the outcome. He will go around sharing the gospel of Christ, right? He will preach as much as he can. He will minister to people as much as he can. But he doesn't know the outcome. The outcome is in God's hands. But he is hoping that in doing all these things, in being all things to all men, somehow, by all means, some of those people will be saved. So this tells us that we should keep sowing, right? We should keep doing good to others, keep reaching out to others. We should learn to be sensitive to people's needs and look for opportunities when we can bless people, when we can say something kind, when we can say something encouraging, where we can have a chance to share with them what God has done in our life, and when the opportunity presents itself, to share with them the message of the love of God. We keep doing that. We keep sowing. We reap whenever possible, of course. But we should not be preoccupied with just reaping, right? Even Jesus reminded his disciples, one sows, another reaps, right? The work keeps going on. We can't say that we will only do reaping, right? Some years ago, a former student of mine shared with me that they were out doing street evangelism with a church. And he said, today we have so many PRCs. When I heard, wow, we had so many PRCs, I thought, wow, these people are very committed in reaching out to the mainland Chinese. I was very happy. Then I realized, what is PRC? PRC means pray to receive Christ. I said, oh, I see, pray to receive Christ. So I cautioned him, you go out doing street evangelism, you just sow. You must not be preoccupied with forcing people to pray to receive Christ. Because some people may have to hear it 10 times. Some people may have to hear it 1,000 times. And finally it clicks and they turn to God. Some people hear it once and immediately they jump and they receive the message of God. We don't know. God alone knows, right? And in his divine wisdom, he has planned all this. Some will not turn to him even after hearing 10,000 times, right? God alone knows. It is not for us to judge. We shouldn't say, this person, no hope, I don't think he will ever be a Christian, right? And neither should we be too preoccupied with reaping, always wanting people to say that sinner's prayer. Sometimes they are just not ready, right? But we sow and we continue doing good. We continue waiting, continue praying and looking. And at this point, I'd like to share a personal testimony about my family of origin. When I became a Christian in my late teens, I was the only convert, the only believer in a family of 10. I'm the youngest of 8 children. In my youthful enthusiasm, I clung on to this verse. I became a Christian and I immediately started reading the Bible from cover to cover, pouring through Numbers, Matthew, the genealogy, that really didn't make sense, but I just forced myself to read through from cover to cover. And then I read this verse, Acts chapter 16, verse 31, where Paul said to the jailer, believe in the Lord Jesus, and you will be saved, you and your household. I say, wow, isn't it great? I believe in Jesus and my household will be saved. Not just me. And I clung on to that verse and I prayed to God. I kept bugging him, that you promised me, not just I will be saved, my family will be saved. Of course, as I grew in my Christian life, in my understanding of Scripture, I realized that's not what Paul meant, right? But Paul is saying, believe in Jesus and you will be saved, and then dash, you and your household. The same principle applies to all, right? If you believe, you'll be saved. Your household believe, they will be saved. But God is so gracious. Even in my ignorance, I prayed and I prayed. But God knew my heart's intent. 14 years after I became a Christian, both my parents got baptized. It was a long time, but I thank God. You know, I never gave up hope. I kept praying and I kept looking to God. And my father was very impressed by what God had done in my life. He could see God's power. He could see God's work. He could see God's blessing, God's goodness. And from the people in the church that he encountered, he could see God's love is real. And he told my mother, "You want to be a religious person, go and be a Christian." You know, it's very interesting. At that time, my father was not a Christian, but he said that to my mother. And through the years, eventually, after 14 years, both of them became Christians. They were baptized. And along the way, three of my brothers became Christians. Sadly, today they have backslidden to varying degrees. So what do we make of that? You know, when my brothers became Christians and then they backslided, they are no longer in church. Well, one of them has been in and out of church, reading the Bible and then stopped reading the Bible and then stopped. You know? So are they backslidden Christians or were they never really converted at all? Really, we don't know. Can you answer that question for sure? Can I answer that question for sure? No. But I cling on with hope. I pray and I keep hoping that that first conversion was genuine and that today they are backslidden. They are not non-Christians. They are children of God, not otherwise. They are disobedient children of God, right? Just like sometimes our children are disobedient children, but they don't cease to be our children, right? So I cling on to this hope. I keep believing and I keep praying. And I trust that my brothers are still children of God, although they are disobedient. Another brother became a Christian as well. This is even more amazing. This brother was a staunch atheist in his younger days. In his 30s, I think late 30s, one Sunday, somehow God led him into the church. He rode his motorcycle into the church. And then he sat through the sermon. And at the altar call, he went forward and received the salvation of Christ. And then he signed up for baptism class. Much later, I found out that David Chan, our missionary's mother, was in that same baptism class. They are old friends. And about 10 years ago, my brother retired from teaching, and then he enrolled himself in the Baptist seminary in Penang. And today, he's serving as a Baptist pastor. God is amazing. God does miracles. Sometimes the people you least expect to become Christians become Christians. Sometimes the people you thought will definitely become Christians, they hold out, they hold on against it for a long, long time and refuse to believe. You know, this staunch atheist brother of mine, when he became a Christian, I couldn't believe it. You know, I was fasting and praying for my family every Friday, and when my mother called and said, "Your brother wants to get baptized," I said, "Don't joke." And I felt God slapping me in the face, you know. After saying, "Don't joke," I felt like God slapped me in the face. "What is this? You've been praying for so many years, and now he says he wants to get baptized. You don't believe it." He said, "Don't joke." Sometimes that is our lack of faith, you know. We pray, we may fast, and when it happens, we can't believe it. But I thank God today this brother is serving the Lord. I have yet another story to tell you. When I was 25 years old, a dear friend of mine died. He was 28 years old. He was serving as a pastor in Penang. You know, we grew up together in the youth fellowship. And when he died, I cried. And I was very sad. And I heard the story that before he died, while he was in coma in the hospital, his parents have said, "If God will now heal our son, we will believe." You know. So we were all praying, the word went around, all praying that he would come around and the parents will believe. Oh, but he went to the Lord and we thought, oh no, that's the end. No. We were thinking, how will the parents ever believe now? Right? They said this to God, "If you will now heal my son, we will believe." But God took their son. But you know, in an amazing turn of events, in God's divine purpose, through the funeral, they saw what Christian faith was, and they saw what the love of God was through the community, and they were so convicted that this must be real. They said, we want to follow our son's way, and they became Christians. They got baptized. The mother was serving fervently in the church. You know, she was always there for prayer meeting, and the father volunteered to be a van driver on Sundays to pick people on Wednesdays, visitation and so on, and they were serving the Lord faithfully. We don't know how God works, but God wants us to be his instruments. God wants us to be his agents, to keep living that faithful life, to keep doing good for others, to keep sowing the seed of the gospel and preaching the message of Christ whenever the opportunity arises. In closing, I'd like to share this definition of evangelism. I went on the internet to find the source, but I can't find the source, so I cannot acknowledge where it came from. But I learned this in the late 1970s. Some of you would know, in the late 1970s, there was this saturation campaign called I Found It. That was in preparation for the Billy Graham Crusade. So I was involved in this I Found It campaign, and the trainers gave us this definition of evangelism that just stuck in my head for a long time. You know, that's like 40 over years ago. You know, I never forgotten this definition. Evangelism is sharing the gospel of Christ in the power of the Holy Spirit and leaving the outcome to God. And it's very important in the power of the Holy Spirit. It's also very important leaving the outcome to God. We don't know what will happen. We can't predict, we can't determine the outcome. But God wants us to keep doing it, to keep at it. Sometimes it will take a long, long time. Sometimes the response never comes. We don't know. God alone knows. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that in your divine purpose, in your grace, you want us as your agents, as your instruments in the work of evangelism. You could have done it your own way, Lord, but you want us to be part of this work. And we pray, God, that you will give us today this same deep passion that Paul had for the salvation of others, that you grant us also this wisdom to be all things to all men, that by all means we might save some. In Jesus' name, amen.